this two-part lecture, we're going to cover fatty acid catabolism, looking at how stored triacylglycerols are mobilized, how fatty acids are released and transported into mitochondria, and how these fatty acids are oxidized to acetyl-CoA, a process called beta oxidation. In this video, part one, we're going to cover how stored triacylglycerols are mobilized and how fatty acids are released and transported into mitochondria. So let's get started. Now, if you have seen the amino acid metabolism lecture, I touched on how we have three sources of organic fuels: glucose from carbohydrates, amino acids from proteins, and fatty acids from fats. And so we're going to focus on the pathway of fatty acids. So before we discuss how they are released from lipid droplets, let's take a step back and answer what makes lipids ideal as energy stores. So we have the structure of a simple lipid here, three fatty acid chains bound to glycerol. This is triacylglycerol, and they are an ideal energy storage because lipids are neutral, which means they have no ionizable groups. They are insoluble in water and inert in storage. They're happy. Fatty acids are reduced. They are fully unhydrated, meaning they have no water bound to them, which means they have less weight to carry around. And when we oxidize fatty acids, we can yield energy. So similar to how we harness energy from glucose oxidation and amino acids. And all of these pathways connect at oxidative phosphorylation when we're producing ATP. Now, before we oxidize fatty acids, we first need to release the fatty acids, okay? So lipids are stored in adipocytes, in fat cells, and they are in lipid droplets. And in order to release the fatty acids to mobilize the triacylglycerols, release it from storage, hormones need to trigger this process. And this happens when the body needs energy. And once we've released the fatty acids, it can be transported to muscle, heart and skeletal muscle, and renal cortex, where they can be oxidized and broken down for energy. So this happens when we have low blood glucose levels or in a fight or flight situation. So glucagon is secreted when we have low blood glucose levels. Now, the way I remember this is glucagon, glucose is gone. Okay, so glucagon is secreted when we have low blood glucose levels. Now, another hormone that is also secreted in a fight or flight situation is epinephrine. So now let's subtract complexity and break down what happens when glucagon is secreted. Okay, so let's go through the process and the pathway and the reactions that occur when glucagon is released. So when glucagon is released, it's going to bind to its receptor in the membrane of the fat cell, adipocyte membrane, and it's going to stimulate adenylyl cyclase via a G protein. And when it does that, ATP is going to come here. Here's ATP, and it's going to produce cyclic AMP, which is an intracellular second messenger, okay? Cyclic AMP, or CAMP. And this is going to trigger protein kinase, PKA, because protein kinase is cyclic AMP dependent. And when we trigger and activate protein kinase, it's going to phosphorylate the hormone-sensitive lipase. So it's going to add phosphate groups, phosphorylate it. And it's also going to phosphorylate the paralipin molecules, these purple things here, that's on the surface of the lipid droplet. So lipid droplets have paralipins on the surface, so these purple things. They are proteins. I think of them as security gates of lipid droplets to prevent lipids from being mobilized unless it's required. And so when paralipins are phosphorylated, the protein CGI58 that binds to paralipin is going to break away. And when it does that, it's going to trigger acylglycerol lipase, ATGL, to stimulate lipase activity. And what acylglycerol lipase does is it turns triacylglycerol, so here's our triacylglycerol, and it's going to turn it to diacylglycerol. So that's what acylglycerol lipase does, is it turns triacylglycerol to diacylglycerol. So, from diacylglycerol, what do we do with diacylglycerol? If we come back to the paralipin here, that is phosphorylated, what it does is it interacts with hormone-sensitive lipase that's also phosphorylated. It was phosphorylated by protein kinase. And the hormone-sensitive lipase comes to the surface of this lipid droplet, and it's going to convert diacylglycerol to monoacylglycerol. So then from monoacylglycerol, the next step is the monoacylglycerol is going to be hydrolyzed by a third lipase called monoacylglycerol lipase. So now we have free fatty acids, and these fatty acids are going to leave the adipocyte and be transported in the blood. But before we move on and talk about how they are transported in the blood, let's do a quick recap on what we've just covered. Okay, so when we have low blood glucose levels, glucagon is going to be secreted. So glucagon, glucose is gone. And when glucagon is released, it's going to bind to its receptor in the membrane of the fat cell, and it's going to stimulate adenylyl cyclase via G protein, this G protein here. And when it does that, ATP is going to produce cyclic AMP, which is an intracellular second messenger. And it's going to trigger protein kinase, because protein kinase is cyclic AMP dependent. And once we've activated protein kinase, it's going to phosphorylate the hormone-sensitive lipase and the paralipin molecules that's on the surface of the lipid droplet. So we're going to be adding phosphate group onto this hormone-sensitive lipase and also the paralipin molecules that's on the surface of the lipid droplet. So lipid droplets have paralipins on the surface. They are proteins. They prevent the lipids from being mobilized unless it's required. And when paralipins are phosphorylated, okay, we've added phosphate groups to these paralipin molecules, the protein CGI58 that binds to paralipin is going to break away. And when it does that, it's going to trigger acylglycerol lipase to stimulate lipase activity. And what acylglycerol lipase does is it's going to turn triacylglycerol, okay, three fatty acid chains bound to glycerol, and turn it to diacylglycerol. And from diacylglycerol, it's going to be converted to monoacylglycerol by the hormone-sensitive lipase. Okay, so this paralipin here that's phosphorylated, it's going to interact with the hormone-sensitive lipase. And from monoacylglycerol, the next step is the monoacylglycerol is going to be hydrolyzed by a third lipase called monoacylglycerol lipase. So now we have free fatty acids, and these fatty acids are going to leave the adipocyte and be transported in the blood. But in order for them to be transported in the blood, they need to bind to the blood protein serum albumin. And the reason why they need to bind to this blood protein is because this protein is soluble and fatty acids are insoluble. So the fatty acids are going to get on this beautiful boat where they are transported to skeletal muscle, the heart, and renal cortex. And when they get there, they're going to enter the cell via plasma membrane transporters where they are going to be oxidized, they're going to be broken down to yield energy. Now we've also produced glycerol. So this glycerol here can enter the glycolysis pathway. So now that the fatty acids are released, they must enter the mitochondria to be oxidized. And the reason why they need to enter the mitochondria is because the enzymes involved in fatty acid oxidation are found within the mitochondrial matrix. So the fatty acids must be activated and then transported into mitochondria. Now, fatty acids with carbons of 12 or less can enter the mitochondria without membrane transporters, but fatty acids with 14 or more carbons aren't able to do this. So they go through the carnitine shuttle, which involves three enzymatic reactions. So let's break that down. The first step is we need to activate the fatty acid and convert it to a fatty acyl CoA. This is catalyzed by fatty acyl CoA synthetase. So in this step, we're going to be adding a CoA, and this also requires ATP to activate this step. Then in the second step, the CoA is going to be substituted for carnitine to form fatty acyl carnitine. And this is formed in the outer membrane by carnitine acyl transferase 1. So then fatty acyl carnitine is going to move into the matrix by passive transport through the acyl carnitine cotransporter. And once it's in the matrix, the fatty acyl group is transferred to CoA. So we're going to be putting the CoA back. And this is catalyzed by carnitine acyl transferase 2, which is found in the inner mitochondrial membrane. So now we have free carnitine here. And this carnitine is going to go through the carnitine cotransporter again. It's going to move back to the intermembrane space, to the outer membrane, where it can repeat this process. And that is how fatty acids are activated and transported into mitochondria. Okay, so let's quickly recap the process of transporting fatty acids to the mitochondria. So firstly, we combine fatty acid and CoA to produce fatty acyl CoA. So we've activated the fatty acid by adding CoA, and we also required ATP in this process. Then in the second step, we're going to substitute CoA for carnitine so that it can pass through the intermembrane space and enter the matrix through the carnitine cotransporter. And then once it's in the matrix, the final step is the fatty acyl group is going to be transferred to coenzyme A. So we're going to be putting the CoA back. So now that we have the fatty acids in the mitochondrial matrix, it's going to be converted into acetyl-CoA, which is a process called beta oxidation. And that is what we're going to cover in part two of this lecture. So that is fatty acid mobilization and transport. In this lecture, we learned that glucagon is secreted when we have low blood glucose levels. So when glucose is gone, we broke down how triacylglycerols are mobilized and how fatty acids are released and transported into the blood by binding to the blood protein serum albumin. We also learned that the reason why we need to activate and transport fatty acids into the mitochondrial matrix is because the enzymes involved in fatty acid oxidation are found within the matrix. Thank you for watching this video. Make sure you subscribe to EKG Science so you don't miss a single lecture. And remember, subtract complexity and slow down. To study the next lecture, simply click the next video, or you can view the entire metabolism playlist. Hey, stop procrastinating!